subtract. Last time we had discussed about obstructive uropathy, various common causes we had seen, long list. This is the list of obstructive uropathy. Hydronephritis is the term used to describe dilatation of renal pelvis and calyces associated with progressive atrophy of kidney due to obstruction to outflow of urine. Initial function alteration is largely tubular and later GFR begins to diminish. This is the partial obstruction hydronephrosis, partial hydronephrosis. This is the hydronephrosis. This is the entire kidney with wound present, and it has to be distinguished from part. It is the part of the chronic pyelonephritis. Erythrolithiasis, stone formation anywhere in urinary tract, males more predominant than females, and process starts around 20 to 30 years. Inborn errors of metabolism like gout, cystinuria, primary hyperoxaluria may be important. So stone can be formed in the calyces, renal pelvis and bladder, and it may obstruct the ureter or here and urethra. Prevalence of various types of renal stone, calcium oxalate and phosphate, magnesium ammonium phosphate or triple phosphate, uric acid, cysteine and unknown. Calcium oxalate stones, calcemia and hypercalciuria to it, calcium oxalate stones, hyperuricosuric calcium nephrolithiasis. Here calcium oxalate is formed around the uric acid. Hyperoxaluria may also may cause without calcium increase form. Calcium oxalate stones, hypercitrituria associated with acidic urine. In a variable proportion of individuals with calcium stones, no cause can be found. Magnesium ammonium phosphate stones formed by infection by bacteria, protease and staphylococci, they convert urea to ammonia, and in alkaline urine, precipitation of magnesium ammonium phosphate occurs. And these are smooth and therefore they may form staghorn calculi. Uric acid is more common in individuals with hyperuricemia such as gout and rapid turnover. In contrast to stones, uric acid stones are reduced. Increased concentration of stone constituents may be the important mechanism by which it is occurring. Along with there might be alteration in the urinary pH that may aggravate. But sometimes it is not occurring because of just only increase in concentration. And in that situation, inhibitors of crystal formation in urine may be important. Lack of that may lead to occurrence of the stone. Pyrophosphate, diphosphonate, glycosaminoglycans, osteopontin, citrate, a glycoprotein called nephrocalcin. These are the inhibitors of stone formation. Then we had studied benign nephrosclerosis. Benign nephrosclerosis is the term used for renal pathology associated with sclerosis of renal arterioles and small arteries. The parenchyma effects include glomerulosclerosis, chronic tubular interstitial injury. Benign nephrosclerosis will be contracted granulomatous. It has to be differentiated from pyelonephritis and chronic pyelonephritis. Leathery, fine granule the surface of the kidney, and it may be or bilateral, but waste between 100 to 100. In case of chronic glomerulonephritis, 100 grams. And here, around 1 to 1.2 centimeter. The chronic glomerulonephritis and 1 centimeter. By nephritis in chronic polynephritis, coarse granules. This is the close fine granules, leathery granules. It will be showing hyaline ichthyosis. There might be foci of tubular atrophy and interstitial fibrosis, and a variety of glomerular alteration may be there. Clinical features is in uncomplicated benign nephrosclerosis, cause renal insufficiency, will not be causing renal insufficiency or uremia. Moderate reduction in renal blood flow, but GFR is normal or only slightly reduced. On occasion, there is mild proteinuria. Malignant hypertension, on gross inspection, the kidney size depends on the duration and severity of the hypertensive disease. If prior benign nephrosclerosis has occurred, the fine granular surface will be seen. And along with that, because of malignant hypertension, there will be small pinpoint petechial hemorrhages may appear on the cortical surface from rupture of arterioles or glomerular capillaries, giving the kidney a peculiar flea-bitten appearance. Microscopically, it will be afferent arteriole, onion skin, more close fibrin and nigro, and this is onion skin. Surface of onion, how does it appear? Like that, this appears. Now we come to last non-neoplastic condition. Completed glomerular disease, we have completed tubular diseases, to interstitial diseases, and lastly we have covered. Now we come to a miscellaneous disorder of renal cystic disease in details, but you should know what it is, and therefore we are going to discuss summary of renal cystic disease. Polycystic kidney disease, childhood polycystic kidney, medullary sponge kidney, familial juvenile nephroptysis, adult onset medullary cystic disease, simple cyst, acquired renal cystic. So first, adult polycystic kidney disease. Inheritance is are genetically inherited. Only few cases there is inheritance. So it is autosomal dominant. Features: large multicystic kidney, liver cyst and brain aneurysm. Diagrammatic representation: large multicystic cyst present in the kidney. Clinical area: flank pain, urinary tract infection, renal stones and hypertension. Features may be related to urinary tract infection, renal stones and hypertension. Urinary and flank pain may occur because itself. Chronic renal failure at 40 to 60 years of age. Even it is inherited, is produced around 40 to 60 years of age. Childhood is autosomal recessive in nature. Enlarged cystic kidneys at birth. Hepatic fibrosis is clinical features related to it. Variable outcome is there. Death in infancy or childhood. Medullary sponge kidney, no inheritance. Medullary urography, patient comes with hematuria, urinary tract infection, recurrence, and typical outcome is benign. So patient survives this. So this is the appearance of this type of cyst. Juvenile nephronophthisis, autosomal recessive, corticomedullary cyst, shrunken kidneys. There is salt wasting, polyuria, growth retardation, and excessive renal failure beginning in childhood. This familial juvenile nephronophthisis and adult onset medullary cystic disease both have almost similar picture. In onset medullary cystic disease is autosomal dominant in nature. Again, cortical medullary cyst and shrunken kidneys are there. So features are same. Salt wasting and polyuria. Again, the progressive in childhood and chronic beginning. organs, cyst, kidneys, microscopic hematuria may occur, outcome is benign. So here only single cyst is seen. Generation kidney disease. So we have seen hydronephrosis or pyonephrosis, that type of picture will be seen. Cystic degeneration in end-stage kidney disease. Hemorrhage, erythrocytosis, neoplasia. Dependence on dialysis. Required dialysis. Summary, renal cystic disease. Completed plastic condition of kidney. Now we turn one more thing about this photographs. This A and B are autosomal dominant adult polycystic kidney disease, ADPKD, viewed from the external surface and the kidney enlarged with numerous dilated cysts. Third is autosomal recessive polycystic kidney disease, showing smaller cyst and dilated channels at right angles to the cortical surface. And liver showing again polycyst, cyst in adult polycyst. Both will be generally together because it is autosomal dominant in nature. So we complete this non-neoplastic conditions of kidney. Now we turn to tumors of kidney. It may be benign or malignant. Benign, renal papillary adenoma, renal fibroma or hamartoma, angiomyolipoma and oncocytoma. These are the common benign tumors. Malignant tumors, renal cell carcinoma, Wilms tumor and urothelial carcinoma of renal pelvis. Out of this, we are going to discuss renal cell carcinoma and Wilms tumor in slight detail. Others will try to cover it in short. First, renal papillary adenoma. This renal papillary adenoma is a benign tumor occurring in the renal tubules, and it may be accidentally found in autopsy, and generally it is less than 3 cm in diameter. Morphologically, it may be slightly cystic and may produce papillae of these tubules. Tubules are arranged in papillomatous formation, and therefore it is called papillary adenoma. Generally it is less than 0.5 cm. Less than 3 cm will be calling it benign. But over the years it has been seen, because microscopically the low grade or well differentiated papillary carcinoma of kidney resembles this picture of adenoma, papillary adenoma, and the genetic changes are also seen related to papillary carcinoma, and therefore it is potentially considered as malignant irrespective of size. Previously it was considered less than 3 cm, it should be called benign. More than 3 cm, it should be called malignant. So grossly it will be producing a 3 cm well circumscribed mass, yellowish in color, and it may be showing papillary structures. So that is about renal papillary adenoma. It has to be distinguished from renal cell carcinoma. Second is renal fibroma or hamartoma. Hamartoma we had discussed in neoplasia, that normal tissue in any organ, if arranged in haphazard manner and if it is growing, we may call it hamartoma. It is not neoplastic condition, but it resembles neoplasia. So if fibrous tissue only is growing, we may call it renal fibroma. This is mainly occurring in the medullary region. So if other things are also there, it may be called hamartoma. It is haphazard arrangement of normal tissue. Third is angiomyolipoma. Angio means blood vessel, myo means muscles, and lipoma means fat. So when these three components together form a mass, it is well-circumscribed mass is formed, then we call it angiomyolipoma. It is occurring in the medulla of kidney, and it is very common finding, and it occurs 50% of cases, along with associated with tuberous sclerosis. You will be learning about tuberous sclerosis in other time, but it is related to brain abnormality in the brain, and it is genetic abnormality also found in that. So angiomyolipoma, proliferation of blood vessels, muscles, and fat, and present in the medulla of the kidney. Fourth is oncocytoma. This oncocytoma word will be coming in different organs also. It may be, you might have learned, in salivary gland, it might occur in the thyroid gland, etc. This oncocytoma is nothing but a eosinophilic cell with benign looking nucleus. So a cell which is highly eosinophilic in nature, with central or central nucleus round to oval, with its size is small, like benign, and small nucleolus may be present in it. This oncocytoma is important because it may produce a size around 12 centimeter in diameter, and so huge mass is produced, but uniform cells are seen in microscopy. They are eosinophilic in nature and small nucleus is there. Therefore, it has to be differentiated from renal cell carcinoma. In renal cell carcinoma also, sometimes benign looking appearance may be there, but here the homogeneous appearance of the cytoplasm plus the throughout the mass, the uniform appearance will be there. Malignant tumors, renal cell carcinoma. Renal cell carcinoma occurs in 1 to 3% of all visceral carcinomas. So it is one of the common condition. 85% of renal carcinomas, means whatever tumors occur in the kidney, mainly they are called renal cell carcinoma, so appearing from tubules. Most common in older individual, usually 6th to 7th decades of life. Here renal cell carcinoma is arising from the tubular cells, while the oncocytoma is occurring from the intercalated cells in the distal in ducts. Most common in older individuals, usually 6th and 7th decade of life. Male preponderance is 2:3:1, so twice or thrice common in males than females. Previously they were known as hypernephroma due to gross yellow color and resemblance of tumor cells to clear cells of adrenal cortex. So it may be confused with normal adrenal tissue, and therefore it was previously called hypernephroma. Generally these tumors are on one pole, upper or lower pole, and therefore it was confused. Arises from tubular epithelium, hence adenocarcinomas. Not because of arises from tubular epithelium, but because they are forming glandular or acinar structures. Etiopathogenesis. Tobacco is the most significant risk factor. cigarette smokers have double the incidence of RCC than do non-smokers. Other risk factors are obesity, hypertension, unopposed estrogen therapy, and exposure to asbestos, petroleum products, and heavy metals. Obesity, hypertension, unopposed estrogen therapy, and exposure to asbestos, petroleum products, and heavy metals. So these are the high risk factors. There is also increased risk in patients with chronic renal failure, acquired cystic disease, and tuberous sclerosis. Most are sporadic, but autosomal dominant familial cases occur, usually in younger individuals. So most are sporadic, but autosomal dominant familial cases occur, usually in younger individuals. So basically two types, papillary and clear cell. So both are sporadic and hereditary. Hereditary are less in number, but because we are clear cell carcinoma, we could understand the occurrence of tumor in this type of lesion. So clear cell and are histologically identified. Sometimes grossly also we may be able to identify. The main thing occurring in clear cell is there is translocation and 3q11, and there is deletion of chromosome 3, leading to loss of VHL gene. One VHL gene will be lost because of this and deletion of chromosome 3. So on chromosome 3, this VHL gene is present. VHL means von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. This von Hippel-Lindau syndrome, in brain there is it may be hemangioblastoma may occur or retinoblastoma may occur, and in kidney the renal cell carcinoma occurs. So this is VHL gene is important, and it is suppressive gene. So only one gene if is affected, it is not going to VHL gene has to be compromised. So one is lost because translocation and deletion activated, either mutation or hypermethylation of VHL are inactivated, and it may cause sporadic clear cell adenocarcinoma or hereditary clear cell carcinoma. In hereditary renal cell carcinoma, so VHL Hippel-Lindau syndrome, there might be multiple clear cell carcinoma. Another papillary carcinoma, there is trisomy in acquired or sporadic 17, and loss of Y is important. Because of this there is mutated and activated MET cell. MET is considered as proto-oncogene. So activation of that may cause proliferation. Another loss of Y, translocation between X and 1. It is called papillary renal cell carcinoma oncogene. So it is lost, and then it may cause renal cell carcinoma. In hereditary, only one type of lesion is there, that is trisomy 7, mutated MET proto oncogene is there. So these are the hereditary condition which may cause helping in occurrence of neoplasia. Hereditary leiomyomatosis and renal cell carcinoma syndrome. This also may be occurring causing renal cell carcinoma. There is mutation in FH gene. There is cutaneous and uterine leiomyomatosis and RCC. Both are present. Another abnormality or syndrome may lead to occurrence of renal cell carcinoma is Brick-Hogg-Duke syndrome. Here there is autosomal dominant inheritance is there. BHD gene is involved. There is expression of polyculin is there. And in this case, there is constellation of skin lesions, pulmonary cyst and renal tumors. Histologically and cytogenetically and genetically, it is classified into four groups: clear cell carcinoma, papillary carcinoma, chromophobe carcinoma and collecting duct, Bellini duct carcinoma. Bellini duct carcinoma is rare, chromophobe carcinoma is common but less common than clear cell and papillary carcinoma. Morphology, most commonly pores, especially upper pore, is involved in the kidney. Grossly spherical mass, it may be well circumscribed. Please remember this because it may resemble the adenoma. It is well circumscribed mass. Sometimes it may be penetrating around, but generally it is spherical mass, varying in size, bright yellow to gray-white tissue, but distortion of renal outline will be there. There might be areas of necrosis, so that will appear gray-white. Foci for hemorrhage and discoloration is there. So there is mass is bright yellow, gray-white necrosis and hemorrhage. So multicolor appearance may be there in case of renal cell carcinoma. It is called variegated appearance. Variegated appearance it is called, and is common in renal cell carcinoma. It is for differentiation with Wilms tumor, and therefore this variegated appearance is important in case of renal cell carcinoma. So yellow mass, gray-white necrosis and hemorrhage and other discoloration. Foci of softening is there. Margins are sharply defined. Margins are sharply defined and confined with the renal capsule. Papillary tumors may be multifocal and bilateral, typically hemorrhagic and cystic. As tumors enlarge, they bulge into calyces and pelvis and fungate through the walls of collecting system to extend even into ureter. It is penetrating this calyces, pelvis going up to ureter or bladder, but it is not disconnected with the primary tumor mass. In that case, it is not metastasis, it is just infiltration. Striking characteristic of this tumor is tendency to invade renal vein and grow as a solid column within this vessel. Further extension produces a continuous cord of tumor in inferior vena cava and even in right side of heart. So mass present in the kidney, the mass has penetrated renal vein and in a column form it is going up to right heart, but it is not disconnected with the primary tumor and therefore it is also not called metastasis. But this behavior is likely to cause metastasis. So this is the gross appearance, this is the kidney, and you can see over here mass, round to hole mass is there, appears to well circumscribed, capsule is stretched on this side, but well circumscribed mass, lobulated, yellowish appearance is there, and in between hemorrhagic areas are seen, and here there is necrosis. Here thrombus blood vessel is there and tumor has gone in over here. Papillary carcinoma, it is cystic in appearance and it is generally papillary carcinoma. Here carcinomas have shown as in a restricted cava into heart be removed. So that metastasis in mass and through the vein. Leading to hemorrhagic, is it adrenal? May renal cell first this renal cell from metastatic because there might be multiple. We have seen in case of papillary carcinoma, von Hippel-Lindau syndrome, multiple. So how to differentiate metastatic tumors from is the case where irregular masses are seen. This masses is presence can make out. There are umbil in these masses, multiple. What we umbilication, I think we have, I will revise it. Metastasis occurs to leave any organ. Tumor cells are coming in abundance. In this area, but the globe at which this on kidney and other place grow its blood supply, mass may be formed, may not be able to get supply, and in that necrosis will be followed by and this fibrosis will travel you from all direction. There will be therefore it will be difficult for the pull tissue inside the surface. Yes, there will be depression. And therefore, this type of umbilication center is pulling tissue inside, and therefore, multiple irregular bilateral masses metastasis. Another kidney metastasis, many of which show. Umbilication from necrosis. The classical histology carcinoma, the clear cytoplasm is in nest with intervals. So nest are there, are there. tumor cells, nucleus is small and abnormality is not much seen. Cytoplasm is clear in nature. This is why they are often called clear. Tumor cells are rounded or polygonal shape, abundant clear or granular cytoplasm. Spatial stains show glycogen and lipids. Because of these lipids, actually yellow color appears on cross examination. Vasculature is delicate. It may be cystic or solid areas there. Most are well differentiated, but some show marked nuclear ectopia with formation of bizarre nuclei and giant cells. So only few cases it will be marked nuclear ectopia and bizarre nucleus and sometimes giant cells. Papillary carcinoma formation, low columnar cells are there. We have discussed in pathology nothing but layering salts, and there are types of tumors, tumor of tumor, thyroid, anti vascular. Microscopically and grossly, chromophore, eosinophilic, with this is from cinema. Perinuclear is important. Eosinophil while on Nixon. Next is collecting the carcinoma is rare. Channels typically with pattern. Nil means seen. There is a side of the present bulging that it will have side called in all types clear collecting pattern. Present may update it in form so one must remember that pattern in the clear cells some amount appearance. These foam cells are present in the papillae. It is carcinoma. These are carcinoma. The pale yellow are arranged in sheet in size and betting it at places round at places clear. Clinical cross. Three classical diagnostic features. Costovertebral pain, palpable mass, and hematuria. Costovertebral pain and hematuria is have seen in case of nephritic syndrome, but palpable mass is not present there. Here palpable mass will be present. So costovertebral pain, palpable mass and hematuria. Hematuria is most reliable. So any hematuria present, one should investigate the patient. There is generalized constitutional symptoms of any neoplastic condition, that is fever, malaise, weakness and weight loss. Sometimes incidental finding, sometimes number of paraneoplastic syndromes may occur. We have learned about paraneoplastic syndrome, in which we may not be able to identify why these features are there, but it cannot be explained by readily. It will be ultimately explained, but not readily to the mass. So any extra function is occurring. So differentiation is occurring in different direction than normal tissue. In that case, there will be formation of paraneoplastic syndrome. So polycythemia, patient may come with polycythemia, and you find for polycythemia, we find the there is mass and it is causing the polycythemia. Hypercalcemia, hypertension, hepatic dysfunction, feminization or masculinization, Cushing syndrome, leukemide reaction and amyloidosis. These are all paraneoplastic syndrome which may be occurring because of renal cell carcinoma. Characteristic feature is to metastasize widely before giving rise to any local signs or symptoms. So no mass may be felt, no discomfort, no hematuria, no pain, and patient come with some mass in other places, like metastasis are occurring in lungs, bones, lymph nodes, liver, adrenal and brain. Lungs, bones, lymph nodes, liver, adrenals and brain. So these are the various sites where commonly metastasis occurs. Prognosis. Average 5-year survival rate is about 45%, up to 70% in case of absence of metastasis. So we can remove whole mass. Figure reduced to 15-20% in case of invasion of vein extension into perinephric vent. Partial or complete nephrectomy, choice of the treatment. Next tumor is Wilms tumor. Most common primary renal tumor of childhood. It is mainly occurring in the blastemal tissue. So therefore it is occurring in childhood. All blastemal masses like retinoblastoma, this Wilms tumor will be occurring in childhood. Hepatoblastoma, all will be occurring in childhood. 5-10% Wilms tumor involve both kidneys. Means both kidneys will be involved, and it may be horseshoe shaped kidney will be there. The precursor of this tumor is generally considered as rest of blastemal tissue in the kidney. Risk is increased in association with at least 3 recognizable groups of congenital malformation with distinct chromosomal loci. So it is generally associated with genetic alteration. WAGR syndrome. W means Wilms tumor. A means aniridia. G means gonadal dysgenesis. Genital abnormalities or means mental retardation. And this Wilms tumor 1, WT1, is a tumor suppressor gene which is present on chromosome number 11, P13. So in this Wilms tumor WT1 is altered, and in that situation, along with other factors are altered, then WAGR syndrome will be occurring. So in iridia, no iris, genital abnormalities and mental retardation. Another syndrome, Dennis-Dash syndrome. In Dennis-Dash syndrome, there might be again similar area is there, but here there will be genital abnormality will be predominant along with the Wilms tumor, and this Dennis-Dash syndrome is more common to cause Wilms tumor. Third is Beckwith-Bademan syndrome. Here the organ will become enlarged because of genetic alteration. It may be only on one side. There might be tongue may be enlarged, hyperglossia, or all organs may appear enlarged on one side. So hemi enlargement of organ may be seen. It is called Beckwith-Bademan syndrome, but this syndrome is associated with WT gene, WT2 gene. First one was WT1 and this is WT2, and it is located at P11 number chromosome P15 area, not P30. So these three conditions may lead to occurrence of Wilms tumor, and precondition rest of the blastemal tissue may be the precondition or generally present in this situation. This is the gross appearance of Wilms tumor. This is small kidney. 4 years old child containing a lobulated tan white mass. Lobulated tan white mass. This is Wilms tumor of the kidney. Many are now known to be associated with genetic defects on chromosome 11. Here you should note that it is in the center. Poles are spared, and that is the characteristic of Wilms tumor. In case of renal cell carcinoma, it is generally on the poles. The children with Wilms tumor usually present with abdominal enlargement from the mass effect. Nowadays, treatment gives a better than 90% 5-year survival. This is another case. You can see the ureter, and this is the kidney, and center there is mass. Wilms pole of characteristic tan to gray color and well circumscribed. Macroscopic characteristic feature is main issue. Any blastemal tissue is means the with enlarged almost no cytoplasm is, and the nest or and this is the when this blastemal it may try to differentiate to various because they have differentiate in different types of cells. In Wilms tumor, tract is there. The tissue may appear as blastemal tissue like this, form glandular tubules or so. Composed microscopically of nest and sheets of at the left, renal parenchyma at the right. When blood present in these, it will be present in between the glomeruli. So normal in will be present, by is one side. It is from normal tissue. This resembles zone of kidney. The tumor shows primitive glomeruli. This appears to be tube formation. It is producing mass in the function also is slight on the size. Removal of this mass may be a treatment. The third tumor is urothelial carcinoma. Will not go in detail. It is a tumor arising from transitional cells and it generally produces papillary structures. Urothelial carcinoma may precede by papillary tumor, transitional cell papilloma. It is common in renal pelvis and urinary bladder, more common in bladder, but it may occur in renal pelvis. So differentiating from transitional papilloma may be difficult, but generally this may penetrate the muscular layer, both places, renal pelvis and urinary bladder. By that we may be able to identify. Other than that, in the high grade papillary carcinoma, features of malignancy will be seen. In case of low grade, it may not be seen properly, but cap cell may be destroyed and thereby we may be able to identify urothelial carcinoma. It may cause either blockade of the ureter, it may cause hematuria because sloughing of these papillae may occur. So hematuria may also occur, blockade by this papillae of the ureter and urethra may occur, that may cause obstruction. So we will not be going in detail of that. So that finishes kidney tumors. Before ending, I would like to share with you one video related to affective domain. We have discussed about affective domain and how it affects us, that also we have discussed. So I would like to share one video which may give some perspective of affective domain. I'll stop because it appears that you are not able to. I'll go to another PowerPoint which may in the affected domain, life. These plants leisurely life with his paycheck, but he never they could get. The contractor was sorry to see such a good worker go. One more house as a personal. The carpenter said yes. It was easy to see it was not in his shoddy work and used inferior material. It was an unend a dedicated career. When the carpenter finished his came to inspect the house, he handed it to carpenter. This is the year, said it is my gift to you. Shocked. What a shame. If he known he was building his own, have done it also differently. So it is with us. We build a day at a time, often putting less than our best into building. We realize we have to leave we have built. If we had do it much different, we cannot go back. You are each day you have a walk. And the choices you make are how to build wisely. Thank you. So we come to end of this lecture series. Thank you. करता है तो कर
करता
है। ये तो नहीं करता है। नहीं, कसे जाए